Okay, welcome everyone. Tonight is a council work session. It is for the purpose of discussing the ACE Task Force. As a work session, council can deliberate, discuss, we cannot make decisions. And so the purpose of us all being here is to hear from different parties with opinions, to hear for council to discuss and ask questions, and for us to hear from the community. So the first thing we'll do is ask our clerk to call the roll.
Yes, Wintrow.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
Hausch.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Astley.
Yes.
Also present are Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zandt, Village Manager Patty Bates, and I will leave the introduction of the panelists to the moderator and to Mary Ann McQueen.
Thank you, and with that, I will turn the meeting over to Mary Ann McQueen.
There are some seats up front and a couple seats on the other side. Also, we do have overflow seating in
the... We're not live, so it's not going to work over in that
room. Yeah, we don't have overflow seating. Well, we have overflow seating and standing in the hallway, I guess. First of all, thank you for coming. Very much appreciate your involvement in this issue. As you probably know, Yellow Springs, the Village of Yellow Springs, is a member of the ACE Task Force, and our panelists will talk more about what the role of the task force is. But the issue of whether or not to be involved in the task force is a contentious issue. There are people with differing viewpoints on it, and people who feel very passionately about this issue. So as I've been thinking, how can we have a discussion that is as deep as possible, one that we can listen to each other as much as possible? I've been thinking about, you know, it's not so much about the task force, being on the task force is a strategy. It's a strategy to meet certain goals. If we look beyond that particular strategy to what the goals are, I think we'll probably find some common agreement. And so I ask you to be thinking about that. What if you're for the task force, what are your goals about being on it? If you think you shouldn't be on it, what are your goals? And we'll talk a little bit about that and try and look at where the common interests, common goals lie as we talk together. This is also not going to be the only time that this topic will be discussed, but it is the only time that we're devoting fully to whether or not to be on the task force. Council has made a commitment, I think, to make a decision by the end of this year whether to remain or not remain. So that will... that decision will come in our regular council meetings. So I'd like to introduce the panelists, and then I will turn it over to our facilitator after I've introduced our facilitator. So beside Judy Kintner is the director of the ACE Task Force, Bruce May.
Thank you for having me tonight.
And our chief of police, Dave Hale.
Evening.
And Patty Bates is... our village manager is sitting in the middle of the panel. Then to Patty's left is Cheryl Smith. And beside Cheryl is Romani Moyenda. And Cheryl and Romani will be talking about their concerns about the task force and their concerns about Yellow Springs being part of the task force. Now, I'd like to introduce Bernie Okun. Bernie is a member of the Village Mediation Program, and she's facilitating this meeting as part of the mediation program. And I'm going to turn the meeting over to her, and then at the very end, we will come back to council as a wrap up and say whatever our next steps will be.
All right, can everybody hear me in the back? Okay, all right. So the way that we structured this tonight is first, We'll hear about the advantages to village participation from Chief Hale and Commander May. And they'll have 15 minutes to speak. And then we'll hear about the drawbacks from Ms. Smith and Mr. Moyanda. Is that close? Okay. And they'll also have 15 minutes. And then we'll have some time for comments and questions from council before it's opened up to the public. As Marianne was saying, we want to hear from as many voices and to hear as many different viewpoints as possible. So it's important that we try to stick to the time limits, and I'm going to be managing the time. And we ask that public comments be left to 2 minutes. And so if I cut you off, please know that I'm doing that as a sign of respect to the people who haven't yet been heard. This is obviously a very important and emotional discussion. If it were not contested and confusing and ambiguous, there would not be a need for tonight's group. So we really want to hear as many people as possible, but we also want to make sure that we keep things respectful and civil. After a person speaks, I'm asking that you please not clap. If you support what they've said, at the end, if you could raise your hand as a show of support rather than clapping, because I want everyone to feel that their voice is welcome, and I don't want anyone to feel intimidated by that clapping. We want to do everything that we can to not chill speech and not chill comments or different viewpoints. So again, if we can keep things as respectful and collaborative as possible and really focus on looking towards common goals, I think that would be helpful to the council from what I've heard. Are there any questions about the ground rules before we get started? Yes, sir.
I think 2 minutes is way too short a time to have any substantive, and some of us have invested quite a bit of effort into our comments.
I understand. Unfortunately, that's the time limit that we've agreed upon at this juncture. Yes.
So we have to balance letting as many people and as many viewpoints be vocalized as possible. However, anyone can approach any individual council member. You can write emails. You can write letters from paper. So there are other means of getting your concerns.
Yes, sir.
Can I or someone else choose to donate our 2 minutes to Al so we can have four?
Unfortunately, not everyone is going to have an opportunity to speak. The way that we're going to determine speakers is that there's going to be a list passed around, and we'll go off of that list. We're doing the best we can in the limited amount of time. I want to get as many viewpoints heard as we can. Yes?
So much of the first two parts of the meeting, will comments from council also be allotted 15 minutes?
Council, excuse me, will have half an hour.
No, 20 okay. minutes.
And the public will have.
We have 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay.
15 to 20 minutes. Yeah.
I can't do math on the fly.
And you're not saying that the public response on how long that will be?
Yes, the public will have from about 8:10 to 8:45 if everything stays on task. Okay.
And I just want to say, that we will be talking about this more. So this will not be the only time you will be able to be heard. So we want to keep this meeting to a reasonable time frame.
All right. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over then to Chief Hale and Commander May. And I'm a stickler on time, so give you a 2 minute warning, guys. Okay.
Mainly one of the things I want to do is clear up some of the misconceptions people have about the task force. When I got here, a lot of people wouldn't confuse SWAT and the ACE task force. They are two completely separate entities. The task force is an organization that is set up to look at organized crime which include drugs and includes other things. SWAT is a unit ran by both Xenia and the county that respond to situations of high risk to officers. The ACE can use the SWAT team to do an entry if they need, but they are not hand in hand, they are not conjoined, they have no parts of each other.
With that, Chief, we called the SWAT team to help us about as many times as you do per year. Years. We use them maybe one time a year at most. Okay. We use the SWAT team about one time a year, average, and we only use it for high-risk situations. And I retired from Dayton after 25 years. I'm glad to be here in Greene County. The high-risk situations aren't here like I experienced over in Dayton. And so we very seldom use the SWAT team, but we use them just like you do. We call them for emergency purposes only.
One of the things Director May has pointed out is about 65% of their cases are in fact drug cases. The other 35 are non-drug cases. Things like bilking the elderly, and there was a tree trimming service that went throughout Greene County, and I think part of Clark County, and they bilked the elderly out of money. That's a very hard thing for a uniform officer to investigate. And by combining efforts and using the task force to do this, well, instead of getting minor convictions in 8 or 9 different jurisdictions, they in fact were able to convict these people under engaging in a pattern. Is that what you end
engaging
up with?
A pattern of corrupt activity and against the elder.
Yes.
And you may not have had us knock on your door. You may not have seen us investigating it here because we can only pick 2 or 3 cases. And I'll use one down in Bellbrook. It was $100,000, and they took about 6 trees, about like this, out of somebody's yard. How they bilked most people was telling you you had diseased trees when you did not, and they would take a tree you loved out of your yard and charge you 3 times as much. But we took our prime cases, and there was 4 main participants. They all got 8 years for defrauding the elder, and that was here in Greene County. And some of the participants, or some of the victims, we're all over Greene County, virtually in every jurisdiction. Go ahead.
One of the cases I worked on was part of, there was a HVAC guy in Montgomery County who was telling elderly people the motherboards and their furnaces need replaced. And he was charging them $5,000 to $8,000 to replace a non-existent motherboard. The guy had $1 million+ in his safe when they hit him. That is done by organized crime units. They also look at gun trafficking, human trafficking. Bruce and I, when I was still with Montgomery County, worked a case known as Band of Thieves. These guys went through multiple counties, Dark, Green, Montgomery, Warren, Miami, and we cleared over 180 burglaries and thefts by working together in an undercover capacity, following these guys around in unmarked cruisers, getting up at dark 30 in the morning. It actually got solved because Bruce and mine's old butt went to bed because we lost these guys. One of the younger guys stayed on the house and found them coming over stolen property. They got 6, 7, and 8 years respectively in what would Montgomery County be probation cases. And this is the kind of work they also do.
The Band of Thieves also led to the gun trafficking guy because he was in cahoots with him. Although he was doing that HVAC stuff, he bought 2 ATVs that belonged out here in Greene County. That they were just ripping everybody off, as we have so many people that inundate our county from outside and hurt us. Go ahead.
Gambling, retail crime rings, car theft rings, and murder for hire cases. Very hard to put an undercover cop when he's in uniform out to do a murder for hire case. That's the only way to prevent them often, is to insert an undercover, and that's what it gives you. One of the misconceptions is that the task force just comes in and takes people's money. There is about 20 plus pages in the Ohio Revised Code as the protocol on when we can take money and under what conditions. And if we seize money because we believe the profit from drugs, it does not mean we get that money. It has to go in front of a judge. For property to be forfeited, it either has to be indicted by a grand jury or turned over to a police department by a judge. If you've inherited $10,000 and you just sold your buddy 2 joints, guess what? If the police may be able to seize that money and hold it temporarily, there's not a judge around that's going to give us that money, because that is not a rational profit for selling 2 joints. It's not going to happen.
Sir, again, ACE Task Force does not benefit from any of the seizures. If we get $70,000, we have 70 participating agencies. Each one of them immediately, when it comes to the sheriff's office, that's who keeps our federal funds, and the prosecutor keeps state funds, it immediately goes seven different directions that same day just by pushing the computer, and they all get $10,000. If we need something, they may give it to us. And matter of fact, I believe that your money doesn't pay that $10,005. We actually give it to you because it's seized money that's yours, and you use that $10,005 to give back for us for the what the board decided was the monies needed to pay for our grants. You have to pay 25% for every grant that you get, and that's what it's used for, is to pay for our grants that pay for my administrator, myself, and Green County's never paid a dime for my administrator and I in 17 years. The grants pay for it, and we get it from those that are doing wrong, illicit gains.
Go ahead. The law also specifies on how that money can be spent, and we're sort of limited on that.
Chief, could you please back up to, I think you missed a slide.
You gonna double click?
No,
okay.
It's just a weird transition.
No. Okay. Yeah, right. It's supposed to look cool. It's cool on a laptop. It loses it up here. What the law requires is that some of that money that's taken has to be used in certain areas, and some of which is to fund community education and prevention programs. That is the money that we just told the school, the elementary school, that we would buy them new safety equipment. We are making a $1,500 donation to Spidey, which is an organization to promote diversity and stop bullying. This is the money that we put an ad in the yearbook. We spent $500 on an ad in the yearbook, which is a very expensive ad, but we can do that because that helps the yearbook out. This is the money that people come to me and says, hey boss, hey chief, can we get this? This is not taxpayers' dollars that are going out. This is money that is taken from criminals. One of the misconceptions is that Yellow Springs does not have much of a problem. I was talking to an individual a couple days ago who's in the know. I'm not going to front him out, but he is in the business to know this stuff, and predominantly, if I'm not misquoting him, he says that Yellow Springs has approximately the same percentage of abuse and addiction per capita in this area as anywhere else, any other city in this county. So I think we're putting our heads in the sand if we don't believe it and we don't live in a bubble. Another misconception, that we want all people we arrest to go to prison and go away for a long, long period of time. I'm going to turn here, and this is a sort of a confusing little chart, but this is the sentencing guideline. And anywhere that you see where it says Division B, Division C, those means that there is a preponderance of those people get probation, and usually if they get probation and they have a drug problem, whether it's I've been burglarizing somewhere because I got a drug problem, or I've been using because I have a drug problem, they are then ordered into court-ordered help. If you look at it under marijuana, you will see, because this is the possession chart, there's a separate one for trafficking, you can actually have 1 kilogram to 5 kilograms of marijuana in your possession, and it is still Division C. So you can predominantly have 11 pounds of weed, and still the court is saying, we should give that person help. That is not the person going to prison. And when you start looking where it says mandatory, you start looking in marijuana, you now have to have over 20 kilograms or over 44 pounds. So you're not talking, this is your buddy, this is your high school friend who got caught with an ounce bag, is going to prison for 2 years because they caught with a little weed. The court doesn't do that. The law does not allow it. And that is not what the task force is about. The task force is about going after people with major weight. The term got used by Mr. Talis Gage, major weight. What do we want? They keep telling, give us guys with major weight. Well, they're not out here going through people's trash to find someone in this community who's using a little weed in their home. Is it legal to do it? If that trash is out of curb? Yeah. It's not what they do. This is a whole other chart for trafficking. I can email this out to anybody who wants it. When you see UD, that is unit doses, and it deals often with heroin that's broke down or LSD. But again, even with marijuana, if you look at it, you can traffic 1 to 5 kilos of marijuana, and although it is in favor of prison, it is not mandatory. And if you're under a key, under 2.2 pounds, you're probably getting probation. but they will take other factors. You get a big record, a little different story. One of the things after 9/11, what did everybody sit and go, why didn't the government do this? Why didn't we connect the dots? Well, this is what you want your police department to do, is to connect these dots. I get to see stuff and know stuff and hear intelligence that I can't always say is 100% true. I don't have enough to charge people, but I got enough to put the dots together. That's what you pay your police department to do. We had a burglary in toward the fall of 2014 after I got here. It was on West South College. It went unsolved for several months. Back in the spring, Dave Meister stops an individual, tries to stop him. He does 65 miles an hour down your residential streets at about 10:30 in the morning. Unfortunately, this individual went to the house where he resides and ran inside. We stayed there long enough, started to tow the car. He came out. He's a heroin addict, admits it in the interview. So we now say, hey, we need somebody to interview. Mr. Bruce May and our detective assigned to the task force came out and did that. From that interview, not only did we solve the burglary down the street from where this individual was residing, we also solved where somebody was floating counterfeit with hundreds, but $400 bills floated. And of course, the businesses that took that counterfeit money was out in money. So that is what we do.
And we got possessions back for some of the people.
We got possessions, yes. And then the other thing, when you go back, and everybody here has been here a long time remembers the Lopez case. That would have been a missing persons case if it wasn't for intelligence and it wasn't for the drug unit. Because everyone thought Mr. Lopez was just missing, correct?
That's this was correct, for 2 years.
Go.
And we had a gentleman up in Columbus that shot a juvenile in the ear, knew how he could get his exposure lower or his charges lower, and said he knew where it was. We interviewed him, which led to all the information that gave us the probable cause to do a search warrant, and sadly we found Mr. Lopez in the backyard in Yellow Springs. From that, we were able to solve the crime, give closure to the community, to the family, to everybody here, and that's a sad state of affairs when you have to do that. And again, I'm glad we don't have to do it much in this county. But we also experienced from that, interviews and everything, a lot of people told us about an organization that was funneling drugs to your kids, to everybody in this Yellow Springs village. The gentleman that was responsible for it was getting his drugs from Chicago, Arizona, everywhere. He left Yellow Springs after he was a citizen here for a long time and moved on to Columbus, not to go to school at Ohio State, but to have a big store. This was his franchise. He kept that up until we closed that operation down in 2008. Yeah. He's $450,000, four or five houses that he owned. He never really had a job his entire life. But we did that because we are regional. I believe in regional. I've done regional for the last 20 years. Dwight Osbacher, who's my assistant director, we've got 70 years in the business. I believe in the task force. You have one of the best task force, if not the best task force in Ohio and Yellow Springs, or ACE Task Force in Greene County. We're here to work for you, through the chief, and through you, with your voice to counsel and everything, to do what you want.
2 minutes.
Got it. One of the other things we gain is a lot of experience. Our detectives who are there, they get search warrant experience, interview interrogation technique, they get to go to court.
Chief, why don't you move to the one that says if we go out, this is what we
want
to do.
Okay.
So you only have two.
One of the things that I think is a misconception is that if we pull out of the task force, the task force just stops and can't come to Yellow Springs. That is not true. But what we will lose is some degree of control in that, because number one, although I'm not Bruce's boss, I sit on the board of directors, so I am one of his bosses. So I have some degree of control what goes on, what the task force does in this community. Although I don't have veto power, I do have lobby power with the other chiefs, and there is some degree of control in that we will lose if we pull out of there. So although they may not come back, they may not come if we request them, they may also decide, we got a lot of things going on, and then it'll be happening, the PD will have no knowledge. They will not let us know until it's done and over with. Do I have another 40 seconds?
Yeah, exactly.
One of the things I want to go over is cost. Predominantly what the cost for, the task force cost us is the cost of wages and benefit for a detective, approximately $70,000 a year. We pay $10,500 in dues. That comes from seized asset. That is not taxpayer money. The $70,000 is. Over the last 5 years, we've received back $271,000 in seized asset money that has went for cruisers and care. So predominantly what it breaks down to is $80,000 over 5 years, $16,000 a year, or $4.33 per resident per year for us to be part of the task force.
Years in. I'll come right in here. This will up and down it. Is it easy to get to, or do you want to? I'm not sure how close.
I was going to say, the number
not that fast. Right. Two versions. Close. I know you want to go file close and then leave it up for him. And at your desk, you good with it? You want me to plug it in real fast?
No, turn the projector off first.
Okay.
Who makes up the board of directors of the task force? Each community representative has a member?
The chief of 5 police departments, the sheriff, and the prosecutor.
Can you get the breakdown of who is on the task force? Which communities are represented and the number of officers from each community?
Fairborn Police Department has 2 people. Beaver Creek Police Department has 2 people. Xenia has 1 person at this time, and then they have a program where they have a different person every 90 days so they get experience in law enforcement and with the task force. The sheriff's office has 1 person at the present time, and they have in their 2016 budget a second person that they plan on bringing out. Yellow Springs has 1 person on the task force, and Sugar Creek Township has 1 person on the task force. We have 3 part-time people from the sheriff's office, and we have 1 assistant director from the Bureau of Criminal Investigation Identification, and we have an administrator and myself.
I have several questions, and I'll just ask them one at a time.
Please.
My understanding is that the United States has about 5% of the world's population and 25% of the world's prison population, and that much of that prison population is for nonviolent crime. So my question is, given that, well, and I think that we have the highest incarceration rate in the world, even though we have not the biggest population. Does that mean that Ohio sentences less than other states? Do you know?
I don't know what we're compared to other states. I do know that, like the task force, in the cases we do, we try to do the best we can in the highest in the industry. It's in vogue right now, and I support cameras on all police officers personally. But whenever we do any investigation, we have 2 to 3 video cameras on every time we purchase, because it's important, and we've done this for 17 years. And it makes our cases a lot better. We seldom, if ever, lose any cases because of that. But it's accountability, and people do not trust law enforcement. But you get to show the prosecutors, the juries, and even the defendants when they come forward, this is what we have against you, and this is what you did. And we're proud of our conviction rate. We're also proud that we help, and that's what I'm, we help people. Just because you have steered wrong and going down the wrong road doesn't mean that you need executed or slapped in prison. We try to give that break, especially for the fourth and fifth degree felonies. We make those recommendations for treatment in lieu of conviction, for community control, which is probation, and we do that. Another thing, just to tell you on how we operate, which I was preparing for this, and again, I come from the other world over in Montgomery County, and sometimes it gets a little rough over there. I was shocked to see, out of all of our hundreds and thousands of investigations we've done, we have never had the use of force in 17 years where we had to use force on anyone. When we serve search warrants, we have community-based search warrants is what I call it, because we don't go up and knock down your door. We'll go up and knock on your door whenever we can. We also will have another reason if you're not home, if you choose not to answer the door, sometimes we have to breach it. But in a majority of times, we have a police officer go up and we knock and wait for you to come there. Especially if one would have a marijuana grow, if one has something so huge, a car he stole or something like that, you're not really going to flush it down the toilet. So there's no really any reason to invade that, because a search warrant is an invasion of your privacy, even if you have the court orders and everything in place, because it makes you feel that way. And by having your chief here on our board gives you that authority to govern me. You know, because what we do is somewhat clandestine. We can't let everybody know. We'd never solve anything. But your chief can guide us in what we do, and they form these policies and procedures that protect you, and is home cooking. It's home cooking for Yellow Springs. It's home cooking for Greene County. It's home cooking for everybody. I don't know if that answer what you're looking for. I don't know the statistics across the world. And people that are in jail, the largest percentage, they tell me, is in there because of drugs. Not because they sold drugs. Because they were high when they beat up their wife or husband. They were high when they robbed that bank. They were stealing money to buy drugs to sell, to support themselves, to support their habits. Drugs seems to have a nexus. There's not a war on drugs. It's a society thing in the United States. They say 66% of the drugs in the world is used in the United States. We're a little spoiled. We're a lot free. And we do these things, sometimes unbridled. And it doesn't help the communities, because drugs do hurt you, and drugs are wrong. And that's why the laws are there. Laws have changed. I can tell you when I started in here, I'm dating myself, but you smoked a joint, you got 20 years. It's a little different than that today, and someday it may be legal. We're here as ACE Task Force to enforce your laws that you have. We can't have a personal opinion about them, and we can't do anything but respect you and the laws that you have. So if we go in a search warrant, do we arrest for possession? We may, if you have it on you when we're in there with the search warrant.
4 more minutes.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Do we want to switch over? Okay, yeah. All right, we're going to switch over then, and they can ask more questions at the end of both sides.
Go ahead.
If you guys are ready, the PowerPoint.
Okay. First of all, I want to say that it really incenses me when I hear law enforcement in Yellow Springs make such disparaging remarks about Montgomery County, Trotwood, Dayton, as if the people there are in some different category, and if that oppression and poverty don't add to the amount of crime that you see in that area. So I just want to make that statement up front, that that is offensive to me, who grew up in Dayton, lived in Trotwood, and raised my children there. So that is very disturbing. The next thing I want to say is that the overall system of criminal justice in America is a system based in racism, classism, and it is biased against you, against poor, and against people of color. So any entity that belongs to that system has to carry that same taint. You can't extrapolate the ACE Task Force from the fact that the law enforcement agencies that are part of it are definitely biased law enforcement. So that has to be carried through to the ACE Task Force also. According to your overview of the task force that I had gotten off the internet, it says that you are to target middle and upper level drug trafficking and organized crime, and yet you definitely target low level drug trafficking and drug addicts. So that doesn't really hold true to what you say. I spent 2 months on the Greene County grand jury a few years ago, and I was able to hear many of the cases that were presented, and they were kids who had drug problems, and yet they were indicted. So there's another side to that also. I also wanted to say that from the chart that I got off the internet also, it looks like 52% of your indictments were for felony 4 and 5s. Certainly that can't rise to the level of organized crime if those were the indictments that came down or the charges. The other thing I wanted to say is that the idea that the spoils of the task force are taken from criminals, that this money that you confiscate, these items that you confiscate, are coming by ill-gotten gain. Well, that's half of the story. The forfeiture that you take, the things that you take, actually come from sick people who suffer from a chronic relapsing brain disease called addiction. The reason these drug dealers have money is because drug addicts pay them. So that's where the money originates. And these drug addicts are not low life, unemployed. They're in every aspect of life. They're working class people who are taxpayers. And the constant reference that this money is not coming from the taxpayers. Well, a heroin addict can be a taxpayer, and a heroin addict who can't stop using heroin is going to give a drug dealer money. And so then you take the drug dealer's money, you're taking the heroin addict's money. And I think that point needs to be emphasized also. I also want to say that these low-level drug dealers who are caught up by this whole task force thing oftentimes have possessions that belong to families. Their children need the vehicles, their spouses, their parents. And you take these things as if only the person that you're dealing with is the one that has need of these possessions. And you take them indiscriminately. And I think that's wrong. And I think also, the other thing that I wanted to say is that the idea of having an overarching task force that is in league with places like Beaver Creek, Ohio, leads to an air of suspiciousness and distrust in this community. Because I don't want the people that are police in my area to be of the same ilk as the people that turn their back on John Crawford. So that's what I'm going to say.
We set a ground rule. Yes, thank you. No, that's okay.
So that's a point of view that I have as a citizen of this village. You know, the other thing I want to say as a chemical dependency counselor and a psychiatric nurse, I see the victims. I see the victims of people who are living their lives impoverished and without what they need, in confusion and disarray, because most of the men in their lives are locked up for nonviolent crimes. And their biggest problem is that they're addicted to drugs and alcohol. And they do go to jail. You know, this idea that we try to keep people out of jail doesn't hold true in my community. It doesn't hold true to the people that look like me. You know, yeah, you give somebody a felony 5 when they're 18, and then a felony 4 when they're 20, and then when they're 25 and they have 2 joints, they're on 3 strikes and they're going to go to jail. So that's just not the whole picture. And you need to really get honest about that. You know, and as I said, the criminalization of addiction does not work. Interdiction does not work. Stop, frisk, harass, and assault does not work. And for the most part, prevention doesn't work. Treatment works. If you're going to collect money from this, then take that money and create treatment centers. Treatment centers that will accommodate working class people. Treatment centers that will accommodate women with babies. You know, where they have child care and they have long term and they are able to get people back in the workforce and accommodate housing and what have you. If you want to make money off of drugs, then this is what you need to do with the money. And if the task force is not geared towards that, then I don't think we should be a part of it. I'm done.
What does that mean? Okay. Go ahead, get it now. And one more. Okay, so unless you had your head in the sand, you will understand like the United States leads the world in incarceration over Russia, South Africa, and I guess the entire continent of Europe. And the majority of these people are what? People of color, poor people, people who've been in poverty and oppressed. There was an article in the Dayton paper a few weeks ago that Greene County has come up with $1.3 million to open up 120 beds or so in the Greene County jail. Man, I can sure think of better uses for that money. What I'm talking about is the nature of policing and law enforcement in general, with a comment in the article saying that there's people, this is a good thing because there's people out there walking around that need to be in jail. So this is like the mindset that's out there. And you know, with that kind of comment, I could easily be viewed as one of those people who need to be in jail just by the virtue of my skin color. I see forfeiture as an incentive for bad police behavior. It's almost like there's a quota system and officers feel like they can be rewarded, given bonuses as such for the seizures that they're out there making. And if you believe that there's no use of force out there that's involved with this stuff, ask the arrestees, okay? I had an experience about 10 years ago, probably too much information, after an altercation with my son, sleeping on my couch, knock on the door, Yellow Springs police officer, two sheriffs come in my back door, I'm seized and pepper sprayed. I filed a complaint about the way things went down. Grody was the chief at the time, and you know, so, and had the police force investigate itself, and we know what that outcome is gonna be. And they actually made up comments that I supposedly said. So I don't trust the culture of policing and the inimical nature that they have towards people of color. Another personal situation I had, And, you know, full disclosure, I had a long-standing drug and alcohol problem here. And after I cleaned up, about 12 years later, Chief Wiley came after Chief McKee had retired. And I just happened to talk to him one day, sitting over in front of the post office, you know, which is unusual for me to be sitting out in public talking to a law enforcement officer. But what he told me was that when he came here, the officers, and this, I had been cleaned up for a dozen years, keep in mind. The first thing they told him was all the problems that I had been involved in, you know, which were mainly DUIs, you know, so I wasn't like out robbing and beating up people. So they were more than willing to communicate that information with them. During the same period of time, I had been doing volunteer work at the high school. I was raising four kids. I was holding a steady job, working as a drug and alcohol counselor. How much of that do you think they communicated? Zero. So there's an inimical situation out there when it comes to law enforcement in general that I don't have much faith in. Another more evidence of that is now we have, after the Black Lives Matter movement has developed, now we have, what kind of billboards do we have out there now? Blue Lives Matter. So evidently, the blue have an innate problem with the black. And until that situation is directly addressed, I will really not have much faith in the criminal justice system. I had a resident of Beaver Creek tell me that the police chief over there told him that John Crawford turned towards the police with a rifle. Now, I've watched the video like dozens of times, and the whole time it was pointed towards the ground. And these people are in a position who can say, who can believe, whatever I say is the truth, you know. However far away from the truth it may be, and then they get backed up. They create boards to back up their decision and continue to put out bad information, which
2 minutes, sir.
Which really furthers the nature of oppression that's aimed at black people. So what I'm gonna tell my 15-year-old grandson, my 34-year-old son, you know, what I'm gonna tell myself when I look in the mirror, and who's gonna keep paying for my high blood pressure medication? It's not gonna come from the forfeitures and seizures. Y'all are not gonna buy my high blood pressure medication. And as far as people not being sentenced to years and years in prison, let me tell you, as somebody who's done, you know, just limited short stints in the county jail as a result of an alcohol problem, which I didn't understand, it doesn't take very long to disrupt and turn somebody, it doesn't take a very long jail sentence to disrupt and totally like uproot somebody's life and that of their family. So, you know, the fact that people aren't going away to prison for a long time, which I find funny because there's a lot of us in there for a long time, you know. people are getting released now after 10, 20, 30 years in prison. So I kind of challenged that presentation.
Thank you, and thank you for cooperating with the no clapping rule. I appreciate that. We're now going to have time for questions. I'm going to go ahead and time the responses because I want to make sure that each side has equal opportunity to respond. So if you could limit your response to 2 minutes, I'll give you a 15-second warning. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, and we will have until 8:10 for comments. Okay, we'll have until 8:10 for comments and questions.
By council,
correct. And then we'll open the floor. And if you know that you want to speak, we have a paper that's going to go around here. So put your name on the list. And again, we'll limit comments to 2 minutes. So, council?
Lori, why don't, let's just go down the line.
I don't have any questions, comments.
I don't need to take up time for questions right now.
Jerry?
Me.
Yeah, I have a couple questions.
I'd like to understand more about the structure of the task force. Because I have a concern about that if a community is not represented on the task force, then they don't really get good service, is my understanding. And for Yellow Springs, with a population of 4,000 in a county of, I think, 160,000, we're contributing about 1/6 to 1/10 of the person power. So that just looking at it from that point of view, it doesn't seem fair. So I'd like to understand a little bit more about how did the structure get set up, and if it's countywide, why isn't it going to serve the whole county equally as opposed to focusing on the particular communities that are willing to be a part of it?
The structure of the task force is set up to serve everybody in Greene County because of the umbrella of the sheriff's office, because he puts, generally, he has two people on there. He will the first part of next year. And that is why we go to Bowersville, we go to Cedarville, and we do that under the umbrella of the sheriff's office. We would do the same for Yellow Springs. When I told you that our officers were up for 3 days digging up that body out here, you weren't part of the task force. We came here for that. All the way to 2005, any of the, which was a plethora of investigations we did, because you're in Greene County and you're right. But when you do anything, communications is the best thing you can have everywhere, including here tonight. That communication that you have with your person on that task force makes it clear any problems that you may have here, be it counterfeiting, be it burglaries, be it tree trimmers, be it whatever it is, they can convey that clearer, more concise, we can work as a team, and we understand we are part of that team that goes in there. Also, when you talk about your money's worth, everything tonight did not compare the fact that that $70,000 that you pay, that isn't giving a task force the freedom to use your man 100% everywhere else. I would like that from all of them, but they have to come back to their home departments. They have to process the felonies and all the arrests that's made by the street officers. They have to investigate in their hometown first. So over 50% of your officer that's given to us is done here. So that 70,000 that was up here in the math, 35,000 of that already is there. About 10% of that time is going to court, meeting with the prosecutors, and doing things with the court that has to do with that officer here in Yellow Springs. So now you're up to 60%. You give that officer 3 weeks off, vacation days for the holidays, and you give them training days.
Hi, sir. Can I respond? I think one of the things, too, that Bruce kind of touched on but it didn't fully explain is the multi-jurisdictional nature of most of the cases that the task force works. they don't necessarily work a case that is only in Yellow Springs or only in Beaver Creek or only in Bellbrook. Most of the cases that the task force works are multi-jurisdictional, and that's what Chief alluded to when he was talking about, you know, you can get 9 separate misdemeanor convictions, but the pattern is there for the gentleman who was going all over bilking people for the tree cutting. And the reason that that came about, and they realized it was countywide, is because all of the people on the task force, the chiefs were reviewing their reports in their jurisdiction and going, hey, I have a case like that. Oh, I have a case like that too. Then you realize that these folks are going everywhere. That coordination doesn't occur unless you have that avenue of communication. So most of the cases that they work are not in one jurisdiction or another. They are multi-jurisdictional.
Well, I'd like to just dig a little bit deeper. Given that we have, I don't know, maybe 2% of the population in Green County, is it possible that if Yellow Springs wanted to still have a foot in the task force, that it could have a foot in the task force proportional to our population?
You'd have to go through the board, and the board, you know, put that, what you have to do is have a full-time officer there. You have to have 2 of the cars that we give you insured, and you have to have $10,500 for a yearly donation toward the grants. That's what they put up. I can't speak for what the board would allow. I haven't seen allowed yet, and I don't know that their statistics are correct. Not that you're not 2% of that, but as far as the time we spend here, whenever we come out and we do investigation here, I'm bringing 4 officers to 8 officers from another jurisdiction working inside your jurisdiction that's being paid for by all those cities that are part of our task force. And for any investigation we do out here, if we make a buy from anyone in Yellow Springs, we usually make 3 buys. You're looking at that force multiplier where you're actually benefiting grossly from those people that are on that board, and that's why they make it, is because their officers come to Yellow Springs and devote their time.
And when you look at like a child abduction, the resources that that would take, we don't have. A missing child that was lost in the woods, we don't have. The first person I would call is Bruce. Get your guys over here. And suddenly I'd have 8 or 10 detectives in addition to what my Yellow Springs bodies can bring in. And then what the deputies and stuff can bring in, and Xenia would come in. That's the effectiveness of the regionalization. That is when you get something that large, it is much more effective use of personnel.
And you're 100% right looking at the way you did, you know, I mean, when you said that. But you don't look at the fact that it is a team, it is a family in Green County, and that we respond to every city in Green County that has a problem. But when we come with people that are giving you time that you don't have the capabilities of because you are small. And you get to benefit tremendously from monies that are being paid from Beaver Creek and everything else. And I think that's the way the board may look at it, but again, I can't speak for the board. It might be a good question to ask them. I don't know what they do, because they might bring up the fact that we give so many people.
And I have one question for Sharon. So if you, I believe, think that Yellow Springs should not be in the task force, maybe that the task force shouldn't exist at all, I mean, I don't know that, at least in terms of the focus on drugs. What do you think Yellow Springs should, if we got out of the task force, what do you think Yellow Springs should do if we know that there is drug use, sales of drugs in Yellow Springs? What do you think we should do?
I think it should be approached the same way I think every city, town, state in America should approach it. The stigma of drug addiction needs to be lessened and removed, and people need to be free to acknowledge their illness and be open and available to treatment. It should not be a criminal offense to be an addict. That's what I think. And I think that drug trafficking has a lot more to do with the secrecy and the clandestine nature of drug addiction than it does with the fact that these people want to be criminals. So I think there needs to be a whole overhaul of the approach to the availability of counseling, the availability of treatment, the availability of wraparound services for people who are caught up in the throes of addiction, where they don't have to rely on this criminal activity in order to survive. That's what I think. And I think Yellowspring should address those things.
And Cheryl, related to that, have you seen some models of this or, you know, communities or places where they're doing programs that go in this direction?
Very, very few. There's a couple. You know, there's none in this area that I've seen.
But
recently there's a, I think a police chief or sheriff out in a town in Massachusetts who just, the whole town is just ravaged with heroin addiction. And he has refused to continue arresting people and just sending them to jail. And he's offering these people like treatment. Okay, I mean, it's real radical. It was in the New York Times in the last couple of weeks.
Vancouver, too, I think. Vancouver, Canada.
But there's still a difference.
Oh, sorry. Vancouver, Canada, I think, also.
But there's still a difference there between the people that are trafficking and the people that are using. And what I'm hearing is that the users are not being jailed. It's the traffickers.
They're not being jailed.
From the police here?
The users would be jailed, not necessarily for the use, but for the crimes that were committed to fuel the addiction.
That's not true. You're telling me that you believe that people who use drugs are not arrested?
If I may clarify, the sentencing chart is what judges have to go by. That is considering no prior crimes. So if you are a F4, F5 possession, no prior record, they have to, by law, give you probation, and you will end up in some form of treatment. Bamani is correct. Once you start racking up felony 4s, felony 5, the judges will take that into consideration, and that changes it. So people can go to prison for a felony 4, felony 5 conviction, especially if they have others or they have a violent history. But that is the chart. That's what they consider when there is no priors. So if I misled anybody, that was not my intent. Again, I'd be happy to explain the chart. And again, most of the time, because of prison overcrowding, when you're looking at possession of small amounts, the judge is going to do everything in their power to try to get them into a treatment program because the cost of incarceration is extremely high. They do not want to do it.
And I'd also like to say that the demographics involved in the person that's arrested has a lot to do with the amount of time they get, the kind of crime that they're charged with, and whether or not they end up in treatment, on probation, or in jail.
Another occurrence in Fairborn right now, Judge Root is starting her drug court, and she's working diligently. Again, she's trying as hard as she can, but that's labor-intensive rehabilitation, meaning there's a lot of people involved in it. It has very good successes all over Ohio, and they pull from different ones that are successful in different municipal courts in Ohio, and I think it will work. And I think that there's a lot of strides being made to do what they would like, meaning our opposition here. It's a tough animal, drug abuse and drug trafficking.
Do you believe?
Well, that sounds like a better use for the $1.3 million they're about to funnel into the Greene County jail.
That's similar to what I was going to ask. Do you believe that we have adequate drug rehabilitation, adequate drug treatment services in Greene County? And is that a subject with, who would be in charge of that? Is it the commissioners? Where does that money come from? And was there any discussion when the decision was made to add 120 beds to the jail? Was there any discussion about treatment?
If I may, I don't have any clue as to what the decision was made from. But if you want to know about treatment, Dr. Franklin Halley is in the crowd. I believe he's... You're willing to speak, sir?
But I can say the task force has nothing to do with it.
Yeah, we were not involved in any way, shape, or form. Would you like to speak about TCN, educate some people?
We have to follow the
agenda.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
I'm on the list. Very good.
You're on the list.
Can I ask one question? And it's kind of jointly between both groups, because I heard the task force statement on the sentencing guide and so forth. and I heard the opposition talk in terms.
Speak up, Terry.
Then I heard the opposition talk in terms of other avenues that could be used. Do we have, as council, have the ability to instruct our chief and this officer is that this is the sentence and the time that they serve, or is it strictly up to the way the courts in Greene County and in Ohio have set it up? In other words, do I have some choices?
I think you have a choice, and it depends how you channel that effort. Do you have a choice to tell your chief what to tell the judge what to do? No, but our judges are very receptive. We don't have that many in Greene County. And I think if you have anybody that you, and that's what they call pre-sentence investigation, if you have a favorable feeling for somebody, and we do it all the time, if we see somebody that is a fourth or fifth degree, first time around, they'll ask us, and they ask us all the time with PSI, this is the first time we've seen this guy. This guy looks like he needs a break. This guy, and then we also listen to the community because people call us all the time, like yourself, like the mothers, like the fathers, and sometimes it's tough love they need, sometimes they need a break. But it's more of a chilling of the community, to him, to I. But can you do it? Yeah, it's how you do it to that judge. But at the end of the day, the judge is the boss. And he needs to hear that, though. And they can't hear it unless you tell them.
Are there any other questions? We've got exactly 2 minutes.
Two or ten?
Two for questions.
I just want to mention that I would like to have access to both PowerPoints since we did not have time to go through all those, and ideally we'd put them on the village website.
Bruce, I do have a question. Do you have a breakdown of the statistics of what communities, the time you're spending, the kind of cases, and you know, just to see what communities are
you mean
getting
like
served?
How many drug cases?
How many
in each community?
Right.
How many
that the task force works on?
It would be rough to do that each year because it changes so much each year, because somebody might get more attention one year or the other. But I may have what you want, because I did the statistics for Yellow Springs since you've been involved, 2005 to 2014, on the different arrests, the drugs that was entailed here, the black, white, the all that. Is that something?
That would be, I would be interested in that data.
Okay, and I'll throw out. And like I said, from 2005 to now, we've had, now this isn't counts, this is bodies, okay? Because every time we do a buy, we try to do three on everybody. We try to do $10, then $20, then $30 to show you that they are dealing. We try to give them a call, that's why we get the video, we get the audios to show that we're arresting drug traffickers, not somebody that's doing you a favor by giving you something, but we get all this jargon on tape and we show what it is. So when I tell you these are bodies, not the amount of times we bought from them, is what I mean. There's a lot of times vested here. So you also, I'd like you to look at 4 to 8 people every time we make a buy. So we have 23 subjects in those years we bought cocaine from. That's 3 times 23, really.
And these are Yellow Springs.
This is all in Yellow Springs. We had 19.
In how many years?
From 2005 to 2014.
So 9 years.
9 years. And those years, this is for trafficking, 19, and 3 times that, but 19 bodies sold marijuana to us. 5 bodies sold heroin to us, 2 bodies sold LSD, 3 bodies sold ecstasy, and then 1 each body for Oxycontin, morphine, Suboxone, BCP, Xanax, hash, ketamine, and Valium. We had 1. That'd be times 3 because we buy 3 times whatever they're selling. The number of people that were arrested in those buys were 30 blacks, females and males, but it's just black race, 47 whites, and 2 Hispanics.
And you have that, I think it would be good for us to have that information.
I can give this page to you. What I got it written right here.
Proportionately to our population, so that's basically something like, it's still very disproportionately black.
I'm glad you said that, because these numbers are, I'm sorry?
This is last response. I want to make sure we have time with it.
Okay, these numbers are skewed, and that is why you need a regional task force, is because these numbers are not representative of your community. Most of these people are coming in selling drugs within your community. Now, one of these people was selling DMT here, had a $1 million lab that we busted. That's the biggest lab I've ever heard of for DMT. But my point is, they're coming from the outside in. Most of these people are not your population. 50% of, and I don't know that number because I didn't look, but I can tell you there's a large contingent that aren't Yellow Springs. They just like, you've got good customers. Or they come here for that reason. But they come here to sell their wares and victimize us.
Right, but you are disproportionately arrested for even for the county population or for Ohio population. It is disproportionately African Americans who are being arrested by those numbers.
Yeah. Not speaking for Ohio.
Proportional to population?
County. No, yeah. I'm just talking about Greene County tonight.
It's definitely disproportionate for Greene, way disproportionate for Greene County.
Yeah. Yes, it would be disproportionate for that. But I can tell you right now, we don't frame anybody, we don't arrest anybody that doesn't traffic, and we do not target. Whether you're blue, pink, or purple, if you're trafficking, we'll come after
you. Please, let's be respectful. Thank you.
DMT, if you don't know, is that form of LSD, is the new, it's an
same
LSD,
thing.
It's a psychotropic, so.
Right.
Thank
you, all. I saw you, Ms. Smith, did you have a response to that? Okay. All right, I think there was a list that was circulated with names. Again, I just want to remind everyone of the ground rules. I know this is an emotionally charged issue. Please, let's be respectful, avoid name calling, obviously, just respect. And again, thank you so much for abiding by the no clapping rule. I want to make sure that voices are not chilled and that everyone feels that their voice is welcome.
It's too late.
Oh, did you guys, did the chart make it around to everybody in the audience?
Perhaps I'm new.
No.
Well,
I think it just. It just
there,
so John, yeah. Add the name.
Just add John.
Just add John.
Sorry. Do we want to start with Dr. Howley, since there was a question? Marianne,
Did he sign the sheet?
Yes, it's on the sheet. But I mean, he should still be given the time to make his comment if he answers the question that was asked.
Okay, I think I would prefer to just go through the list.
It's okay.
Democratically.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to try my best to read handwriting here, so forgive me if I butcher your name. I've got Jeff, and also if you have a comment, 2 minutes. If you have a question, I'll limit the response to 2 minutes per side. Do we have Jeff?
Jeff, right.
The con has been spoken to so far as the ethical situation, and I appreciate very much what you had to share. I'd like to make a practical point against the task force and the war on drugs. It's an utter failure. You know, in the 20s, there was very little organized crime in this country, very little. There was no money, no power involved with it. When prohibition happened and alcohol was made illegal, organized crime flourished overnight. Millions and billions of dollars of profit was made, and to counteract that, millions and billions of dollars in law enforcement all of a sudden was being spent that never was before. When alcohol became legal again, then drugs became the next item to fill that void. So the task force has been in existence 17 plus years. We still have the same amount of drugs. It's available. Anybody can get anything they want. So the primary purpose of the task force, I'm sorry, it's an utter failure. I appreciate the 35% of what you're doing that's not having to do with drugs. But the drugs are still available. And kids can get the drugs because the dealers do not ask for ID. Easier than they can get alcohol, where you have to get an ID. It simply does not work. So the person who puts their head in the sand is the one that keeps pouring billions of dollars into something that's an utter failure, expecting different results. You know, law enforcement for drugs and addiction is simply not working. We've tried it for many, many decades. It's not working. And so far as our village is concerned, we 3,500 to 4,000 people, and we struggle to keep two officers on the street. Some don't believe we need that many. I think we probably do. Jerry Sims, in his in his presentation last week, spoke in favor of the drug task force and spending a full-time officer, but almost in the same breath, sir, you spoke not necessarily against, but questioned, I should say, the wisdom of us taking on the Glen, because if we send an officer in the Glen, then there's the officer on the street by himself. Well, I would much rather have an officer serving our community in that regard than in fighting drugs.
Thank you.
Al Schluter. I'm going to have to try to read very fast. I'd like to make a comment about our involvement with the DRAT, with the Drug Task Force, based on my 45 years in Yellow Springs. I believe that the participation in the task force is not consistent with Yellow Springs values. My comments are based upon conversations with my son, a 1989 Yellow Springs High School graduate. I should also add my son is African American, so and I think that has some relevancy. It's my observation that the police-community relationship has deteriorated in recent years, particularly with our youth and African Americans. I feel that I've gained some understanding through conversation with my son. I asked him if he was ever stopped while driving in Yellow Springs. He said never. I asked him if he remembered being followed by the police. He said no. I asked him if he feared or was uncomfortable with the police. He said never. I asked him if his friends, especially African-American ones, ever talked of being profiled or expressed distrust of the police. He said he could not remember that ever happening. I asked him if he could tell me why his friends felt so comfortable with our law officers then. He replied, Dad, I knew them all. They lived in town. The kids of officers Banner, Pierce, and Nipper were in my class. They knew me most of my life. I saw them frequently at school events. I never thought of them as just police officers. He went on and talked about McKee and how he was so accessible and committed to our community. This is what Yellow Springs is about. Community, knowing our neighbors, supporting each other. We've gotten away from this, especially with law enforcement. Before, all of our officers lived in town, and most lived here for all their lives. Recently, there's an extraordinary turnover in the force, and this is the basis of the problem. If we took some of this money that we spent on the task force and give it as an incentive to officers like Meister, David Meister back there is the only one who lives in town, I think we could go a long way to solving this drug problem in a much more effective way than we are now. Thank you.
Alice Robrich.
Alice? The failed war on drugs has created the mass incarceration we're seeing in our nation, and it disproportionately has affected people of color and the poor. The system is not just. The Supreme Court has been part of this. It has eviscerated the Fourth Amendment right against unreasonable searches and seizures. The court has declared constitutional consent searches where a person is not informed that they do not have to allow the police to search their cars or bags. You know, people are not comfortable telling the police, no, you can't do this, and they're not informed that they have that right. Once arrested, the chance of being free of the system of control are slim. Due to lack of legal representation and due to pressure to plea bargain, nearly all cases are settled by plea bargain. The prosecutor is the most powerful law enforcement official in the system, more powerful than judges. In addition, it seems that clearly the right to keep cash and assets seized in waging the war on drugs is an incentive for more arrests.
Kelly Gallagher? So I just want to say I'm explicitly against the task force. And I actually find it really egregious and patronizing and problematic that the police would sell the task force like this idea of helping the elderly with their furnaces and forfeiture money coming back to us. I find that patronizing and super egregious and audacious. And I just want us to reflect on the role of policing in our society and how policing has acted as an apparatus of the state to uphold white supremacy, racism, and the genocide of people of color, including John Crawford and Tamir Rice, right here in Ohio. So increasing policing in any way, including the task force, sounds like an incredibly problematic and terrifying idea. I'm for money for treatment and not for policing.
And please not. Thank you. Next.
Okay. Chrissy. Okay. Mr. May, when I spoke with you about a year ago about the money that we collected from the task force, you told me at that time that over the five-year period, we had collected $260,000, which came out to pretty much equal to what we had paid to be on the task force. However, what wasn't mentioned by you, I had found out from another source, was that $200,000 of those dollars we received in 1 year, I assume probably from that big bust that you were talking about in Columbus, which leaves about $60,000 over the course of 4 years. And now I find out this evening that our fee to participate in the task force also comes out of whatever we get from the forfeitures. Is that what you said earlier, that $10,000 fee, does it come from the Furtherance of Justice Fund?
It's not a Furtherance of Justice Fund. I have to pay it. I choose to pay it out of seized assets as opposed to paying it out of the budget and out of taxpayer money. That's my decision.
Okay. Just want to clear that up.
And are you asking a question or do you have
And I wanted to recommend to all the council members who are looking into this issue, if you want to see a good representation of a task force bust, you can go to YouTube and put in Greene County Drug Task Force. And several years ago, they did a big bust in Xenia and arrested something like, I think it was 70 people. And what I find most interesting about the video is if you watch, as the people are being drugged out of their homes, you won't see a single person living in a big fancy house or driving a big fancy car. The majority of them were living in cinder block houses with mostly gravel front yards. And so I think that you should look into that, because saying that the task force is only taking down big-time dealers and big-time players, I don't believe that's true. If those people were big-time dealers, they would have been living in a much nicer situation. So I would recommend that all of council have a look at that video.
Hi, I'm Rose Pelzel. So I think this conversation is really very long overdue, and I'm sort of disappointed in the council for not knowing more, or chief for not telling and informing council more about how our police force acts within the county. I think it was it seemed like the strongest argument that's being made tonight for the task force is that if we leave the task force, Yellow Springs will lose accountability. I don't think Yellow Springs has accountability to the task force now. And I think that's a really threatening way of talking about it. If we leave the task force and the task force / the county has a search warrant in YS, would our police force not be told of that search going on, and why is that happening? And I think that's a much bigger question about how our police forces work and communicate within the county, because if we're having to rely on the task force for that communication, I don't think that cuts it. I think that's wrong. I think that needs to be addressed, and that's a really, I'm worried about that, and I think it's not cool that you would threaten that as, if you leave the task force. So I also believe that not having a better alternative, a police force acted on better alternative, doesn't necessarily mean that we should continue doing something that is not in line with our values.
I just wanted to say that, first of all, saying that what we would lose if we left the task force was not meant as a threat. And we were asked to come and say what would happen and what changes would be made. And that's one of the primary changes, is that we would not have as much input into what they do here. It wasn't meant as a threat towards anyone that, oh, don't take us out, or you're gonna, you know, this is gonna happen. We were asked to say what will happen if we withdraw from the task force. That is one of the repercussions of withdrawing.
So if there is a task force search warrant in Yellow Springs, will our police be told about it?
Not until after the fact.
Not necessarily, no.
It's unacceptable.
Undercover.
Okay. Ken.
Ken Odie Warren. I stand with all Bomani and Cheryl and everything that's been said, disfavoring the task force. I think that it has failed the test, and that with due respect to the good police work that is done in Yellow Springs and has been done, and there is good police work, I think we can do better. And with respect to Commander May, police work is not an industry, it's public service, though it has become an industry. And I think it has colored our culture's understanding of what police work is. Presently, it is working to protect elites, not the general people. And I think we really need to rethink that. I think Yellow Springs can do different and better, and they can do it without the task force. And I call upon the council to do something different and better, and to incentivize better police work. It's disturbing to me that law enforcement is funded by seizures. I think that incentivizes bad police work and is prone to fraudulent and crime amongst police forces. As Cheryl said, I think we're criminalizing addiction. We shouldn't be doing that. When what we have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. We should be helping these people to get into service and direct these funds toward mental health, not to poor police work.
Pat, do we?
I do think we should leave the drug task force, and there's a very large national conversation right now about the war on drugs. 2 days ago, President Obama spoke to the Police Chiefs Association, the International Police Chiefs Association in Chicago, and I would recommend everyone to read the text of his address to the police chiefs. And one thing he did say is he encouraged local government to have these very conversations we're having. So I commend the council for that. And I commend the council and Chief Hale for our entire year of forums and discussions about what is community policing and what do we want here. And now I think that we've made some good progress on that, and now we're starting to look at what does the task force mean. And there's decades of evidence, research. If anyone has read the Sunday New York Times very long article about the problems with traffic stops, which is one of the most common strategies in the war on drugs, and the incredible racism inherent in that particular strategy. The title of the article is Driving While Black. And I certainly hope that the council is keeping up with this research, because there's very current and very substantive evidence that we've made a big mistake. And even though it was with good intention, a lot of the outcome has been extremely negative. I mean, inherent racism in practice, tactics, mass incarceration of young people. Even our Congress is currently bringing forward bills to try and stop mandatory sentences, because we know we did it wrong. We have done something wrong, and we need to change it. So I think we need to be aware of that, and we need to understand all of the ways that, as a community, our values don't fit. We do not want to invest in the war on drugs. We do not want to benefit in the war on drugs. We want to, you know, think of a new way, and we've had some very good ideas about looking at some new ways, and we've had some good progress in community policing. So I hope we go forward with that.
Becky Campbell.
Yes. I jotted mine down. It won't take 2 minutes. I've been here 60 years, so I've seen a lot of this carrying on. But Yellow Springs is an intelligent community. I assume that you all are observant of the news, the national and local news. The country's awash in drug addicts and drugs. I cannot imagine how you can sit here and think about breaking away from the task force. Is it money or is it guilt? I want the money that I spend the taxes to be spent on the task force. If need be, reduce or eliminate funds on the affordable housing, mediation, the human relations. I will gladly pay my yearly $4.33 to continue membership. I want to continue to be safe and secure in Yellow Springs. Thank you, Chief Hayes.
Next.
Franklin Howell.
Yeah. Well, I'm a physician, a psychiatrist, I'm a medical director at TCN, Behavioral Health Services. We're the mental health and major mental health and addiction treatment center in Greene County. We have offices in Xenia, Fairborn. We also have youth services in Xenia and Fairborn. Just so you know the scope of our services, we have 180 people that work for us, 150 full-time equivalent physicians. We have 12 doctors, 8 of them full-time. We have mental health therapists, we have alcohol and drug therapists, we have alcohol and drug case managers, we have recovery housing, we have a men's residential treatment facility, we have outpatient treatment groups. We served 6,700 people last year. 210 of them were from Yellow Springs, about 1 out of every 17 people here, so we definitely reach into town here. We served 1,500 adults in our chemical dependency treatment programs last year. There's clearly an opiate epidemic beyond belief in our community here in the county, Ohio, in the United States. Opiates or narcotics, that includes heroin because it's cheap. You might know names, oxycodone, Oxycontin, Vicodin, Percocet, morphine, methadone are all prescription opiates. People start on those and they switch to heroin because it's a lot cheaper. We accept all payer sources, including people that have Medicaid, including people that have nothing. Due to the generosity of Greene County residents, there's a mental health levy, so people can come to our services with nothing, and we will treat them. No appointment is necessary. We have walk-in clinics in Fairborn and Xenia every week. When people are ready for treatment, they can just show up and we will start treatment with them. We work closely with family, friends, and other healthcare providers. We work very closely with the judicial system, Judge Ruth's Drug Court. We provide the treatment aspect of that. We work with all the law enforcement jurisdictions in the county, particularly on the chemical dependency side. There's lots of overlap there.
Martin Borchers.
So this will be a two-part expression of some apprehensions and concerns, considering a pretty casual mention of undercover cars, because I like my officers very clear and visible, and I like their cruisers to be marked with big identifying numbers. So I would like to know what kind of requirements, both circumstantial and institutional, there might be for consideration of implementing the undercover cars, and as soon as they're out in the community, are there any durational parameters in regards to the scope and range of enforcement capacity and undercover discretion? I'd like to think that hopefully these aren't being used that often, and if they are, there being like a lot of oversight. And then I've been torn between either calling it intelligence extortion or coercion if we do leave the task force. but would that ultimately lead to undercover officers in our community without our police knowing about it if we did leave the force?
First, if we left ACE, that does not mean that ACE would not let us know, but they would not have to let us know. So it could mean, yes, there would be undercovers, there could be operations happening in the village and me not be aware. That would be the call of the director and to some degree the call of the board. I could raise a stink about it, but if the board said, nope, Bruce Mayer, you're doing the right thing, they would continue to do that. We have no ability to command, they tell us when they're in our jurisdiction. Undercover cars are used mainly for tailing, for surveillance. They are not used for traffic stops. Ohio does not allow unmarked vehicles to be predominantly for traffic stops. So when I say an unmarked vehicle, an undercover car, that is because we are following someone who we believe is a suspect in a crime. And if we follow them in a marked cruiser, they're probably not going to take the alleged stolen goods back to where they were going. You do that in an unmarked. That is sort of the use of the unmarked. Does that sort of answer your question?
To a point, yes. Thank you.
We also have a deconfliction, which is a national deconfliction. Anytime we work on anybody, we feed that database up. It happens to be housed in Cleveland area. And we send everything in, the person we're working on, social security number, everything that we have on that person, when we're doing it and everything like that. So everybody in law enforcement knows what we're doing. Now, it's not always told to the chief or told to some jurisdiction, because if nobody's looking at this person and nobody ever has, it might not show up on their radar, so to speak. But out of courtesy, I don't care if I go to Oakwood, I let that police department know that we're in their city and what we're doing. That's good.
Does it strike anyone as odd that it's considered a courtesy rather than a requirement?
I'm sorry.
Someone else's community.
I couldn't hear
it. Is it a requirement? No, it is not a requirement. It is a courtesy.
He said, does it strike anyone as odd that it's considered a courtesy and not a requirement?
I agree with you. I wish it was a requirement because we like to know. You know, it's good for sharing.
Okay, Julius Eason.
You're demanding that you end SPD's relationship with ACE Task Force. Village's continued membership with the task force is not only highly disappointing, but indicative of council and YSPD's views on its citizenry and those most adversely affected by it. The war on drugs is a war only the police win. It is successful on a political and bureaucratic level through federal and state forfeiture laws. Police departments stand to benefit greatly by filling their coffers from drug busts and other crimes seen as drug-related, whether directly or through equitable sharing. This encourages policing for profit, where police are motivated less by upholding of law and order and more by maximizing property seizures. Since YSPD continues to ignore the wisdom of over 40 years' experience detailing the failure of the war on drugs, it's clear the only reason we still employ these draconian tactics is that it sustains and profits law enforcement. The problem lies in treating drugs as a criminal offense rather than an issue of public health. This rationale has resulted in a prison population growth of 700%, families ruined as livelihoods are destroyed, and the working class, especially working class people of color, criminalized to disproportionate rates that human rights routinely violated. We demand the Yellow Springs no longer contribute to this problem. We call on the village's reputation as progressive and community-minded and demand that you immediately divest from ACE and boycott the failed war on drugs. It's rooted in systemic racism going back decades, and any continued support of the task force or other drug war policies makes you complicit in the furtherance of white supremacy. Recent comments made by Councilman Sims dismiss concerns regarding police issues as those of a vocal minority. Despite that baseless claim, those of us who take this issue seriously will continue to rally support in opposition of the ACE Task Force until Village Council and Chief Hale decide to do the right thing.
First thing, though, it's kind of hard to sit through hearing y'all say that, because I've been on both sides of the field. Like, you know, I was a dealer at one time, I was an informant at one time, and now I'm on the side of justice. And we'll never end, like, the war on drugs. Like you said, it's a fight that only the cops will win. nobody else benefits from it. The way that we move forward without the task force is with love. Love beats everything. Love destroys all enemies. Love kills everything, period. Love is the dominant force. But with the task force, when I was working with them as an informant, I met a lot of racist people, and they are some straight up liars. They lied to me. They put my name in the discovery packet. And if this guy gets out of prison and he wants me, I'm probably a dead man, because my name was in the discovery packet when these guys told me that my name would not be in his discovery packet and I would be safe. They did not care about me. They wanted their man. They wanted these guys from Chicago that was living in Xenia. It was four of them that I helped them get. And my life is really on the line as I go to Xenia every day to get my son. Every day. Every day. I'm only 8 miles from Xenia, so I mean, once he gets out, if he's not out already, you know, he can come get me if he wants to. You know, because this wasn't his first strike. It wasn't his second strike. This was his third strike. You know, we don't need it. We can't stop it. With me, from my history of being somebody that was a dealer, I know that drugs come from Chicago, Kentucky, Florida. I mean, so we can't stop it. We can't stop it. We lose. We don't need it. We don't need it, you know. So, I mean, love wins everything. That's all we need. That's all we need. And that's all I got to say with 2 minutes.
Can I respond to that? His love might be right, but he's a big liar. He signs a contract with us. We told him the problems that he could have because we can't guarantee anonymity. We can only try. He did 8 people. He did 8 of the larger dealers that we've ever seen. He's right. They were coming from Chicago. He stayed at their house. He dealt with them at their house. He did everything with them at the house. That was his different life. I don't know what he's doing today. I haven't seen him. But I do know that we told him everything. He called us. We did not call him.
The next person on the list would like to pass.
Okay. Essence X.
No, she wanted.
Oh, I'm sorry. What did you say?
The next person on the list would like to pass.
Oh.
So just give it
oh, oh, okay. Lincoln Halpern.
Bring us back to the prohibition example from the 20s and 30s, because the person who brought that up was absolutely right. It largely created organized crime, and it led to a boom in use of the drug which was made illegal, in that case, alcohol. It's also a drug, it's just not illegal right now, so it gets treated differently, and though it's not treated perfectly, it works a lot better than this. Policing drug use is basically repression, and you're never going to put a stop to any kind of drug use, any kind of drug, including alcohol or cigarettes, which I don't like, with repression. It doesn't work that way. And we've seen also, years and years and years, war on drugs. It hasn't eliminated drug problems in our communities. It's largely made things worse, made violence, and made a lot of money for criminals who get to profit off of the illegality of drugs. And I don't want to dismiss the racist and classist components of the war on drugs, because those are huge, but I also do not want to dismiss the concerns about drug violence in communities. And there are communities have of addressing those without policing. Ideally, and in theory, police are delegated by the community, and this is not a task that we can delegate to police if we want to effectively. And I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Okay, we have two more people. Matt Carson.
A couple of things.
Number one, the history of policing is the history of violence, right? The history of violence towards working class peoples, particularly the history of the United States and policing involves the development of armed bodies of men to break up strikes in the North and slave patrols in the South. So if we think that we're going to somehow solve the problem of, you know, racism in policing with more policing, we're dead wrong. It's fundamental to police, okay? Number two, and I think this is really important, the reason why we're seeing an increase in the number of police, the number of private security guards, and these kinds of things, it's called guard labor, technical term for it, has to do with the increasing disparity of wealth in the United States, and particularly in our own community. We're going to rely on police more and more in Yellow Springs the longer we let the issues of economic disparity go. All right, so that's a baseline thing. That said, the war on drugs is basically prosecuting particular businessmen because other businessmen don't like the way that they operate. That's what's really going on, and the fallout from it is basically the harassment and debasement of working class people, particularly working class people of color. Right? That's what we're dealing with. Right? We can sugarcoat it and talk about how the police ought to operate this way, this is how the police used to be, but that's not true. The police have always operated and will continue to operate in a way where they are protecting the interests of the ruling classes, right? Particularly, you know, landowners, landlords, businessmen, small businessmen, big and small, right? And they're going to continue to harass and debase working class people. That's what they do.
Okay,
John.
Let's try to get through as much of this as possible. So, seems to be consensus that drug enforcement does not reduce drug use. You know, amongst economists and the Justice Department, and I hope I'm not misrepresenting you, but I asked Chief Dale about this at one of the forums, and you know, he certainly didn't contradict me. I think he said that at best we keep drugs in the shadows, but certainly I hope that the regular wise police could prevent a,
could you
know.
Speak up, John, please speak up.
Sorry. So anyway, law enforcement doesn't reduce drug use. In the Washington Post, actually, there was a recent article published just a couple weeks ago that stated that, you know, basically users that back up dealers and dealers that back up suppliers. So no matter how much of the network you take out, it doesn't affect the customer, the drug user, their ability to buy drugs. So then to talk about the disparate impact, I was just shocked by that number of blacks to whites that were cited. I mean, that's just crazy. To say that, like, that's because people are coming in from outside, that's just crazy. That does not reflect my knowledge and experience growing up here. What we haven't talked about, what I don't think anyone's talked about, is the effect of incarceration. The negative effects of incarceration are great and various. For the state, a loss of revenue and an increase in expenses. For the inmate, the incarceration has numerous negative effects, some of which are touched on in this passage about how incarceration can lead to both long-term chronic stress and the inability to cope with stress. Stress proliferation occurs when a single event leads to subsequent stressful events while simultaneously undermining one's ability to cope. As discussed above, incarceration can lead to a series of secondary stressors, including traumatic events. There's violence that occurs in prisons. People might get divorced. They lose their jobs. I'm totally at done. Man.
Is that hard? I know.
I'm sorry. Funny job.
Yeah.
If anybody has written comments and you want to send them to council, we will read them, absolutely.
And I really appreciate your abiding by my clapping rule and adhering to the time. I think we got to hear the voices of more people and hear some varied ideas, so thank you for your cooperation. I appreciate that.
And I, again, just want to emphasize what Lori referred to and was stated at the beginning. This discussion is not over, but we will, I think, keep on the timeline of making a decision before the end of this year. And again, we want to hear full comments. You know, 2 hours is a lot for everyone to sit through on an emotional topic. And we want the letters. We want to be contacted. All of this is still something that we need the information on.
I think we're going to bring it back to council, but first I'd like to thank everyone for coming and for people to express their concerns, their questions, and their viewpoints, and also thanking the panelists, Bruce May and David Hale, for talking about the ACE Task Force at this meeting here. Thank you. And where did Cheryl?
I think they're both taking a break.
For Cheryl and Romani as well. As I was listening, I was trying to see where there might be commonalities, and I think the one thing that I felt that, or two things really, are the importance of treatment. I mean, I think that probably everyone would agree that in terms of drug addiction, treatment is probably the most important thing. I think another thing which I was sort of feeling teased out was the importance of community policing, of the police really knowing the community. Not saying that everyone agrees to that, but I think a majority of people agree. But mostly, to me, this feels like a very complex issue, and a complex issue for council to deal with, as we will have to do. So I'm going to bring it back, I guess, to you, Karen.
We're talking about next steps. I mean, I am honestly not sure how we're going to make this decision before the end of the year. We have 20 pieces of legislation on the next agenda. We have probably another 10 to 15 pieces of legislation that we have to get through on the next agenda. So, and the agenda after that. So we are absolutely loaded down with things that we have to do with legislation. So
to me, this is very important, and we need to have the vote, and so we're going to have to do it.
Do we all feel we have all the information that we want? Do we want any more? I would have loved to have heard more from Dr. Holly. Is it
Hallie?
I would have loved to have heard more from him. I would have loved to have heard a little bit broader discussion around addiction, around what the county is doing. I feel like we didn't get complete information for me to make a decision. So I'm feeling lacking. I'm feeling like I don't have all the information I need to make this decision. I have a group of people here who have very strong opinions, who I heard from, and I didn't hear from a lot of other people in the community. And I'd like to hear from attorneys. There are just other people I would like to hear from about the situation before making the decision. If council, you know, I'm one council member, I'm the president, but I'm one council member, the majority of council can overrule that, and we can decide to call a vote. I don't know how the decision will be made. I don't know exactly how it will relate to the budget. I mean, that's two of the votes we have coming up is the budget.
I have a suggestion. There are five Mondays.
Louder voice.
There are five Mondays in November. If you would like to have another meeting dedicated to this topic, and specifically hear from the specific things that you were talking about with Dr. Hallie and other treatment professionals, and perhaps one of the Judge Ruth that has the drug court. If you would like to have another
something
session. It would be the 30th, we'd be the day.
If the majority of council feels like they have the information, I can deal with that. I may end up abstaining. I don't know. I cannot believe that I absolutely agree with treatment.
Yeah. We
I absolutely agree that treatment is absolutely necessary and should be the first, should be what's done. But when there are crimes being committed and when there are broader issues related to drug addiction that can harm a community, I feel like we're not getting the full picture.
It's illegal to close the doors.
I just feel like I'm not getting a complete picture of what the alternatives are. I would like to know what other communities are doing. Maybe that's more than we need to know to make this decision.
For me, Yellow Springs not participating in the ACE Task Force does not end the ACE Task Force. It keeps happening, right? So all the other things are interesting, but it really is a matter of us deciding to invest our money. And the payback, we're told, is that we get a little bit more voice communication than is required. But certainly Mr. May says that he, of course, wouldn't come in, that as a matter of policy and preference, he wants to communicate. So those other issues are interesting and are relevant to the broader issue, but in terms of my vote on whether to invest in the task force or not, I don't feel like they're directly relevant to that decision.
We also are talking about an employee of the village.
Well, we don't. I mean, we could choose to leave the task force and bring the person on the task force back on the police department. Doesn't mean we're necessarily letting go an officer. I guess how I feel is that we're never going to have all the information. I mean, we're never going to have enough information. But I think we need to be able to prioritize what's most important. And it's complex. I mean, there are things that a larger group can do that our police department can't. So if we choose to go out of the task force, which I support, then I think we need to look at are there gaps that we would be creating that we would need to fill, and how would we need to do that. And since we're mostly concerned about the issue of drug, then what are we going to do to step up, whether it's treatment, I guess, get education, whatever it is that we need to deal with the drugs in the community, and also making sure that our officers really do know the community and that the community trusts the officers so that there can be the kind of information that needs to be exchanged in a better way than having to use undercover officers.
Well, what concerned me was when Bruce mentioned the cases that he is working on and the arrests made in Yellow Springs, and if I heard him correctly, these were criminals that had decided to come to Yellow Springs to conduct their business, and that you folks made purchases at least three times, and if I, maybe I missed it, but I did not hear that those people lived in Yellow Springs. So in terms of clarification for me, I'm trying to determine, are the dealers Yellow Springs residents or dealing, or the preponderance of those that are selling drugs are coming into Yellow Springs because the word is we're lenient in doing their due and then leaving.
The majority of the numbers that I gave you were relevant to Yellow Springs and the people living here, and I'd have to say that most of them, if not 50 to 75% of them, from Yellow Springs. But when we work with those people to lower their exposure, they end up calling the people that supplies them that would come to Yellow Springs to sell to them. So in fact, they are supplying other people, and people in Yellow Springs is where the outside entity came with association and affiliation with Yellow Springs.
and with like a wholesale retail market.
Yes, and it's, you know, you're influenced, we're all influenced by the outside entities. I mean, Dayton is the largest metropolitan area close to us. It influences us a lot, but they have what they call source cities all over the United States. Their goal is to get the drugs to the Midwest. And the Midwest has a large population. They don't care what city or village they go to, but they come in here. We've had a couple, I'll say, legal marijuana guys, if they stayed in California, but instead they brought it here. That's against the law. It's still trafficking here in marijuana. They brought 20 pounds in, and things like that occur. They're from the outside, but they want to take advantage of the law by bringing it in here and selling it as best they can. They didn't know they were selling it to us.
Okay. So first of all, I want to say that almost everything I've heard tonight makes sense to me, except for the implication that this council and village administration has not been responsive to local policing policy and these concerns. We've spent a lot of time on this, we've made it a priority, and I'm sure some people don't care, but it's disappointing to me that a few people don't value that amid all the other things that we're dealing with. That being said, I agree, we are never going to get all the information that we probably need, but I'm committed as a council member that we need to make a decision this year before the council changes, so that's what I want to do. But I appreciate, Karen, you sharing that, because I think you're totally right. I would love to get more information. There are lots of questions that continue to be raised, but I think we just have to make a decision. And again, I want to say, since I've been on council, there has been a concerted effort to have forums, to collect feedback, to make sure we understand the values of the community, to get lots of information, to hire a chief and a village manager that's responsive to this, and that's what council's been doing. And so I think most people get that.
Brian, to that end, could you announce the flyer that you've...
Yes, yeah, all right. So one of the initiatives that we've been working on is Coffee with a Cop. So on November 11th, which is a Wednesday from 5:30 to 7, the Emporium, Dino's, and the Spirited Goat will all have our officers for any citizens that would like to interact with them. Okay, yes, they will be off duty. And again, even if all our officers can't live in Yellow Springs right now, they can certainly get to know our community better. And that message has always been extremely important to me, that we have communication two-way.
Can I have a beer with a cop instead? I know it doesn't
matter. They're off duty, Ellis.
Beer with a badge is what I call it.
What day is that?
That's a Wednesday.
November the 11th?
Yes, and we'll have that on the village website.
A little louder.
Yeah.
Veterans Day, actually.
Okay, Veterans Day. Yeah, we'll make sure that's in the YS News. It'll be on the website. It will be, and it's not just a one-off thing. We will continue to do that because this is important.
Okay, what I want to leave here, I will make the decision in 2015. What I want to leave here with is a timetable so that folks know what meetings they're going to come to. I would say not November 2nd, because we have an incredibly full agenda. Let's look at the agenda on November 2nd, if that's okay with everybody, and decide. So this coming Tuesday, or is this coming Monday, we'll look at the agenda, we'll decide if we're going to add an extra meeting, or we'll decide if we can, the way the agenda is looking, we could potentially cancel the December 21st meeting. So maybe we won't cancel the December 21st meeting, and we'll have the decision that night. And I guess it's just a motion. I don't know what form this would come in, is if it's just a motion to say, if it's just a discussion, if it's just an agreement. I could address that.
Resolution, right?
I think it's just a resolution.
A resolution.
If you want to make it truly a formal statement and a declaration of intention, because otherwise it's simply a budgetary question.
Right.
But if you want to make it a formal declaration, then I would do it through a resolution.
Does the agreement we have require specific notice to you in shape or form?
Yes and no. It's just 90 days after that, you don't receive anything else from us. And,
okay.
And you still be by, you know, by the cars and just different things that you have as outside.
So it will probably either be one of the two meetings in December is probably when we'll make the final decision. And we can look at the set that during agenda planning on this coming Monday night. Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Okay, thank you everyone for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks to the panelists and